Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How Europe Underdeveloped Africa by Walter Rodney. Narrated by Mirron Willis. Foreword. Angela Y. Davis. When Walter Rodney was assassinated in 1980 at the young age of 38, he had already accomplished what few scholars achieve during careers that extend considerably longer than his. The field of African history would never be the same after the publication of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. At the same time, this meticulously researched analysis of the abiding repercussions of European colonialism on the continent of Africa has radicalized approaches to anti-racist activism throughout the world. In fact, the term scholar-activist acquires its most vigorous meaning when it is employed to capture the generative passion that links Walter Rodney's research to his determination to rid the planet of all the outgrowths of colonialism and slavery. Almost 40 years after his death, we certainly need such brilliant examples of what it means to be a resolute intellectual who recognizes that the ultimate significance of knowledge is its capacity to transform our social worlds. We have learned from Walter Rodney and those before and after him who have critically engaged with Marxism while developing historical analyses of colonialism and slavery that challenging capitalism's deeply entrenched suppositions about human nature and progress is one of the most important tasks of theorists and activists who set out to dismantle structures and ideologies of racism. In refuting the argument that Africa's subordination to Europe emanated from a natural propensity toward stagnation, Rodney also repudiates the ideological assumption that external intervention alone would be capable of provoking progress on the continent. Although colonization officially lasted only 70 years or so, which, as Rodney points out, was a relatively short period, it was during this period that colossal changes took place both in the capitalist world, that is, in Europe and the United States, as well as in the emergent socialist world, especially in Russia and China. To mark time, he insists, or even to move slowly while others leap ahead, is virtually equivalent to going backward. In How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, Walter Rodney painstakingly argues that imperialism and the various processes that bolstered colonialism created impenetrable structural blockades to economic and thus also political and social progress on the continent. At the same time, his argument is not meant to absolve Africans of the ultimate responsibility for development. I feel extremely privileged to have been able to meet Walter Rodney during my first trip to the African continent in 1973. I mention this visit to Dar es Salaam because it took place shortly after the original publication of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, and because I witnessed firsthand for a brief period of time the revolutionary urgency generated within the scholarly and activist circles surrounding him. Not only did I have the opportunity to witness lectures and discussions he organized at the University of Dar es Salaam on the relation between African liberation and global contestations to capitalism, but I also visited the training camps of the MPLA, where I met Augustino Neto and the military cadre fighting the Portuguese army. Walter Rodney's analyses reflected both a sober, well-reasoned historical investigation shaped by Marxist categories and critiques, and a deep sense of the historical conjuncture defined by global revolutionary upheavals, especially by African liberation struggles at that time. Because he was such a methodical scholar, he did not ignore gender issues, even though he wrote without the benefit of the feminist vocabularies and frameworks of analysis that were later developed. Others have pointed out that he would have no doubt given greater emphasis to these questions had he been active at a later time. Nonetheless, at several strategic junctures in the text, Rodney addresses the role of gender, and he is careful to point out that under colonialism, African women's social, religious, constitutional, and political privileges and rights disappeared, while the economic exploitation continued and was often intensified. He emphasizes that the impact of colonialism on labor in Africa redefined men's work as modern, while constituting women's work as traditional or backward, Therefore, the deterioration in the status of women's work was bound up with the consequent loss of the right to set indigenous standards of what work had merit and what did not. At the time that How Europe Underdeveloped Africa was published, black activism, at least in the United States, was influenced not only by cultural nationalist notions of intrinsic female inferiority, often fallaciously attributed to African cultural practices, but also by officially sponsored attributions of a matriarchal, in other words, defective family structure to U.S. black communities, such as the 1965 Moynihan Report. This book was an important tool for those of us who were intent on contesting such essentialist notions of gender within black radical movements of that era. If Walter Rodney's scholarly and activist contributions exemplified what was most demanded at that particular historical moment, he was assassinated because he believed in the real possibility of radical political change, including in Guyana, his natal land. His ideas are even more valuable today at a time when capitalism has so forcibly asserted its permanency, and when once existing organized opposing forces, not only the socialist community of nations, but also the non-aligned nations, have been virtually eliminated. Those of us who refuse to concede that global capitalism represents the planet's best future, and that Africa and the former Third World are destined to remain forever ensconced in the poverty of underdevelopment, are confronted with this crucial question. How can we encourage radical critiques of capitalism as integral to struggles against racism as we also advance the recognition that we cannot envision the dismantling of capitalism as long as the structures of racism remain intact? In this sense, it is up to us to follow, expand upon, and deepen Walter Rodney's legacy. Preface. This book derives from a concern with the contemporary African situation. It delves into the past, only because otherwise it would be impossible to understand how the present came into being and what the trends are for the near future. In the search for an understanding of what is now called underdevelopment in Africa, the limits of inquiry have had to be fixed as far apart as the 15th century on the one hand and the end of the colonial period on the other. Ideally, the analysis of underdevelopment should come even closer to the present than the end of the colonial period in the 1960s. The phenomenon of neocolonialism cries out for extensive investigation in order to formulate the strategy and tactics of African emancipation and development. This study does not go that far, but at least certain solutions are implicit in a correct historical evaluation, just as given medical remedies are indicated or contraindicated by a correct diagnosis of a patient's condition and an accurate case history. Hopefully, the facts and interpretation that follow will make a small contribution towards reinforcing the conclusion that African development is possible only on the basis of a radical break with the international capitalist system, which has been the principal agency of underdevelopment of Africa over the last 5 centuries. As the one will observe, the question of development strategy is tackled briefly in the final section by A.M. Babu, former Minister of Economic Affairs and Development Planning, who has been actively involved in fashioning policy along those lines in the Tanzanian context. It is no accident that the text as a whole has been written within Tanzania, where expressions of concern for development have been accompanied by considerably more positive action than in several parts of the continent. Many colleagues and comrades shared in the preparation of this work. Special thanks must go to comrades Karim Herji and Henry Mapolu of the University of Dar es Salaam, who went over the manuscript in a spirit of constructive criticism. But contrary to the fashion in most prefaces, I will not add that all mistakes and shortcomings are entirely my responsibility. That is sheer bourgeois subjectivism. Responsibility in matters of these sorts is always collective, especially with regard to the remedying of shortcomings. The purpose has been to try and reach Africans who wish to explore further the nature of their exploitation, rather than to satisfy the standards set by our oppressors and their spokesmen in the academic world. Walter Rodney, Dar es Salaam. Introduction. At the outset, before anything else is written, we need openly to acknowledge how difficult it has been for us to come to terms with the undeniable fact that Walter Rodney, our brother, friend, and comrade, is dead. On June 13, 1980, the author of this unparalleled work of historical analysis became the best-known victim of a systematic campaign of assassination and other forms of ruthless repression carried out by the governing authorities of his native land, Guyana. The end was predictable, for Walter had determined that the only path to true human development and liberation for the majority of the people of his country was through the transformation of their own lives in a struggle to replace and reshape the neo-colonialist government that dominated their society and prescribed their existence. However, Forbes Burnham, the president of Guyana, had made it clear on many occasions that in this struggle for the minds and hearts of the people, he knew no limits in the determination to exterminate the forces of opposition. In the opinion of many, there was no doubt that the bomb that tore away the life of Walter Rodney was the result of Burnham's deadly pledge. Hard as his death is to accept and absorb, we must begin here, not primarily for purposes of sentiment or political invective, but because no new introduction to how Europe underdeveloped Africa is possible without a serious and direct encounter with Walter Rodney, the revolutionary scholar, the scholar revolutionary, the man of great integrity and hope. For, more so than most books of its genre, this work is clearly imbued with the spirit, the intellect, and the commitment of its author, both the man who produced the audacious and wide-ranging study before he was 30, and the man who moved with unswerving integrity to live out its implications in his relatively brief years. With Rodney, the life and the work were one, and the life drives us back to recall the essential themes of the work. In spite of its title, this is not simply a work about European oppressors and African victims, serving primarily as a weapon to flay the exploiters and beat them out their own intellectual games. Of course, it has done yeoman service in that limited role. Rather, there is much more to this masterly survey, and at its deepest levels, it offers no easy comfort to any of us. At one point early in the book, Rodney summarizes its basic message. The question as to who and what is responsible for African underdevelopment can be answered at two levels. Firstly, the answer is that the operation of the imperialist system bears major responsibility for African economic retardation by draining African wealth and by making it impossible to develop more rapidly the resources of the continent. Secondly, one has to deal with those who manipulated the system and those who are either agents or unwitting accomplices of the said system. The capitalists of Western Europe were the ones who actively extended their exploitation from inside Europe to cover the whole of Africa. In recent times, they were joined, and to some extent replaced, by the capitalists from the United States. And for many years now, even the workers of those metropolitan countries have benefited from the exploitation and underdevelopment of Africa. All this Walter supported, with a profuse and creative set of precise examples from many sources, periods, and places. Yet he was not satisfied to pour well-documented blows upon the oppressors, though he was a master at this activity. Nor did it suffice to remind many of us who live in the United States that our blackness provides no exemption from our willing participation in the benefits of our country's exploitation of Africa. Rather, his summary of the book's central themes concluded with words that moved beyond accusation or guilt. He said, "None of these remarks are intended to remove the ultimate responsibility for development from the shoulders of Africans. Not only are there African accomplices inside the imperialist system, but every African has a responsibility to understand the system and work for its overthrow." Unlike many of us who read and write such words, Walter took them seriously. He knew that they were meant for him, for the children of Africa and the Caribbean and the United States of America, for Indians, Asians, and many other sufferers at the hands of European-fueled underdevelopment. Indeed, he knew they were meant, too, for all those Europeans and Americans who claimed solidarity with the Third World struggle for development and liberation. Rodney envisioned and worked on the assumption that the new development of Africans and other dependent peoples of the periphery would require what he called a radical break with the international capitalist system, a courageous challenge to the failing center of the current world order. Of course, he also knew that any such break or serious contestation would participate in and precipitate profound revolutionary changes at the center itself. Thus, from his perspective, what was ultimately at stake, what was absolutely necessary, was a fundamental transformation in the ordering of the political, cultural, and economic forces that have dominated the world for almost half a millennium. This was an awesome vision, especially when Walter dared to say and believe that such a stupendous transformation must be initiated by Africans and other dwellers in the nether regions of exploitation and subordination. Nevertheless, he did not flinch from the implications of his own analysis. Instead, he continued, especially by his example, to encourage all of us to move toward a radically transformed vision of ourselves and of our capacities for changing our lives and our objective conditions. Quietly, insistently, he urged us to claim our full responsibility for engaging in the struggle for a new world order. No one could ignore Walter's work, nor question his call. For he set the example by assuming his own part of the awesome responsibility. That is why he was in Guyana in June 1980. That is why he had been there since 1974, developing the leadership of what was called the Working People's Alliance, WPA, struggling to support his family, somehow finding time to carry on research and writing on the history of the working people of his country and other parts of the Caribbean. That is why he was murdered. In the midst of our sorrow and indignation, none of us who knew Walter could honestly say that we were surprised by the news of his death. For his life carried a certain consistency and integrity that could not be ignored or denied. Indeed, in his relatively brief time, certain patterns were established early. Born on March 23, 1942, Rodney grew up in Georgetown, the capital of what was then British Guyana. From the outset, he was part of a family that took transformational politics with great seriousness. His parents, especially his father, were deeply involved in the development of the People's Progressive Party, PPP. A multiracial party, it was at the time the only mass political organization in the Caribbean that was opening the common people to the world of Marxist/socialist thought, as well as raising the possibilities of alternative futures that might go beyond the mere establishment of independence within the British Commonwealth. So, even before he entered his teens, Walter was already engaged in leafleting, attending party meetings, and absorbing the thousands of hours of political discussions that went on in his home. Then, when he entered Queen's College, the highly regarded secondary school in Georgetown, the young political activist also became one of the scholarship boys, so familiar to West Indian life at the time. Bright, energetic, and articulate, he excelled in academics and sports. He broke his school record for the high jump, and when he won the coveted Guyana scholarship to the University College of the West Indies at Mona, Jamaica, the traditional path to academic prestige and distinction was open to him. In 1963, Rodney graduated with first-class honors in history from UCWI and was awarded a scholarship to the University of London, where he entered the School of Oriental and African Studies to work on his doctorate in African history. Walter's political instincts and early nurturing would not allow him to settle into the safety of conventional academic life. Instead, the years in London were among the most important of his continuing political and intellectual development. He immediately became part of a study group of younger West Indians who met regularly under the guidance of the man who was then the exemplar of the revolutionary intellectual C.L.R. James, the Trinidadian Marxist scholar, best known for his history of the Haitian Revolution, Black Jacobins. The experience with James and the study group was a crucial supplement to Rodney's earlier exposure to the day-to-day life of radical Caribbean politics, and it was also an important source of grounding in intellectual reality as he moved through the sometimes surreal world of the academic community. By the time he left London for Tanzania in 1966, Rodney was prepared to write history from what he later described as a revolutionary, socialist, and people-centered perspective. During the 1966-67 academic year, Walter taught history at the University College in Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. In 1968, he returned to Jamaica to take a post in history at his alma mater and to develop what he planned to be a major program in African and Caribbean studies. More importantly, he wanted to test his convictions about the need for revolutionary intellectuals to remain grounded in the ongoing life of the people. Walter met with initial success in both of these endeavors, but it was precisely this success, especially in his work among the common people of the Jamaican streets, hills, and gullies, that led to a drastic foreshortening of his stay in that country. In less than a year, Rodney had come in touch with and helped articulate the profound discontent and unrest that filled the lives of the ordinary people of Jamaica, as well as many of the university students. As they began seriously to talk and listen together, to ground with one another, about the ways to organize for change, as they heard and pondered the implications of the powerful calls for black power rising in this country, it was obvious that a deep and unpredictable ferment was at work, and the conservative Jamaican government readily identified Walter as an undesirable foreign element. Thus, in October 1968, while attending a black writers' conference in Montreal, Walter Rodney was officially expelled from Jamaica. The government action led to several days of protest in Kingston, but Rodney was kept out. It was this political activity, combined with his powerful participation in the Montreal Conference, that first brought the 26-year-old Caribbean historian to the attention of many of us in the United States. Then, following the Jamaican government's action, Walter's fellow members of the C.L.R. James Study Group and other Caribbean activists, based in London, pressed Walter for the opportunity to publish some of the lectures that he had delivered in Jamaica. With that purpose in mind, they formed the Borgo Louverture Publishing House, and in 1969 brought out Walter's first widely read book, Groundings with My Brothers. Walter returned to Dar es Salaam, teaching again at the university, while Groundings was making a profound impression on many people in this country, especially among those of us who were involved in the struggle for hegemony over the definitions of the black and white experience in the United States, a struggle temporarily crystallized in the Black Studies movement. Not surprisingly, it was at one of the many conferences spawned by that movement that Walter Rodney was first introduced to a major audience of Afro-Americans. In May 1970, he participated in the second annual gathering of the African Heritage Studies Association at Howard University. While one of the contributors to this introduction had already met and worked with Walter at the University of the West Indies, the Howard Conference provided the first opportunity for the other two of us. Like many persons at the conference, my first impression of this slightly built, soft-spoken, dark-skinned brother from Guyana was his capacity to speak without notes, and largely without rhetorical flourish, for more than an hour, and yet have his highly informative material so carefully and cogently organized that it would have been possible to take it directly from a transcript and publish it. Eventually, we discovered that this tremendous intellectual discipline and political instinct was matched by a disciplined force of spirit, a mastery of, but not slavery to, dialectical materialism, and an unflinching commitment to collective work on behalf of the wretched of the earth. All this was insulated from self-righteousness by a dry and ready sense of humor. In other words, it was clear to us that Walter Rodney was a moral, political, and intellectual force to be reckoned with, one of Africa's most beautiful children. From the point of our first encounter, we knew that we had met a brother, teacher, and comrade. At the time of the Howard Conference, Robert Hill, Bill Strickland, and I were working with others in the development of the Institute of the Black World, IBW, an Atlanta-based center for research, publication, and advocacy. Immediately, we began to explore with Walter some of the ways in which he might share with us in this experiment and collective intellectual work. As a result, in a series of visits, he spent quiet, unhurried time among us. In our homes, we also shared the company of his wife, Pat, and their lively children, Shaka, Kanini, and Asha. As our ties were being developed and cemented, the first edition of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa was jointly published by Borgo Louverture and the Tanzanian Publishing House in 1972. For all of us who could obtain copies of the work, it was like a mighty uplifting gust of fresh air. Without romanticizing pre-colonial Africa, Walter had placed it in the context of human development across the globe, traced its real historical relationships to the colonizing forces of Europe, and suggested the path for Africa's movement toward a new life for its people and a new role in the reshaping of the world. The book immediately struck an exciting and responsive chord among many in this country. Among politically oriented Black people, it played something of the same formative role as Franz Fanon's Wretched of the Earth almost a decade before. Indeed, both men were dealing with the ravages of colonialism and neo-colonialism. Both were calling for a break with the exploiting, ravaging system in order to move forward and create a new order. Both were living examples of the transformation they demanded. Like Fanon's seminal work, Rodney's also began from an African/Caribbean perspective, but we in the United States of America immediately recognized the global connection. Although Walter ended his primary historical analysis with the close of the 1950s, he nevertheless offered a brief, cogent, and powerful treatment of the contemporary role of the United States in the exploitation of Africa, implicitly warning us against our own active or passive participation in that damaging work. But there were also connections perhaps even more directly related to the Afro-American struggles in the early 1970s, especially in his treatment of colonial and neo-colonial education and its effects on the African mind and spirit. For instance, Walter wrote, "In the final analysis, perhaps the most important principle of colonial education was that of capitalist individualism. In Africa, both the formal school system and the informal value system of colonialism destroyed social solidarity and promoted the worst form of alienated individualism without social responsibility." We Afro-Americans immediately recognized that condition. Indeed, one of the central themes of the movement for Black studies and Black power have been the call for social solidarity among Black people and resistance to the destructive individualism of the mainstream American way of life. For we were painfully aware of the rising alienation among our young people as they moved ever more fully into the cultural flow of mass American society with its powerful networks of formal and informal miseducation. Thus, it was natural that those of us at the Institute of the Black World, IBW, invited Walter Rodney to participate with us in two projects directly related to those concerns. The first was as a contributor to a book-length monograph, Education and Black Struggle, that we organized and edited for Harvard Educational Review in 1974. His paper was on Education in Africa and Contemporary Tanzania. The second project was of a different nature. Early in 1974, Walter had received an appointment as professor and chairman of history at the University of Guyana. The appointment was considered a clear victory for Walter and his supporters, a vindication of his vision. We invited him to spend part of the summer in Atlanta with us before his return to Guyana. He spent more than a month at IBW, primarily in the development and leadership of a summer research symposium. Colleagues from other parts of the nation and from the Caribbean joined us in the venture as we experimented with models for an educational program that would provide broader scope and new alternatives for young Black people in colleges and universities across the country. At the same time, in an act of vision and courage, the Howard University Press was publishing the first American edition of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. The extended time that Walter spent at IBW that summer was critical to us all. It helped to crystallize much of our thinking about the role of Black intellectuals in our own society and the role that IBW might play in that development. Concurrently, it provided Walter with an opportunity to explore more deeply the implications of the unique Black American experience. Moreover, it brought us all into community with an exciting group of students and co-workers, and we looked forward to the many ways in which we could continue to work together with Walter in his new post at the University of Guyana. However, even before Walter left Atlanta, we had begun to receive signals that all was not well with the university appointment. By the time he arrived home, the official word was given. At the last moment, in an unprecedented move, the appointment had been canceled, apparently the result of pressure from the highest levels of government. From that point on, Walter Rodney, revolutionary scholar, began once more to dig deeply into the soil of his native land. In spite of invitations and appeals from many places, he steadfastly refused to leave Guyana on any permanent basis. He had set himself two major tasks, both consistent with his definition of his role as a Black intellectual who was committed to the liberation and development of his people. both required his presence in Guyana. The first was to develop a major multi-volume work on the history of the working people of his country. The second task, and this was all-encompassing, was to immerse himself in the contemporary life of those same people and search with them to find a way to resist the power of a government that had clearly betrayed their hopes and their trust, a government that now stood in the way of their development. In other words, Walter was still trying to deal with the neo-colonial implications of how Europe underdeveloped Africa, dauntlessly carrying out the search for solutions to the center of his own life and the life of his nation. All the while, especially since Pat, his wife, had also been denied an opportunity to work at her profession of social welfare, Walter had to find ways to feed, clothe, and house his family. Even though it was hard for some of us to imagine how he did it, in spite of a situation of constantly heightening tension and danger, Walter managed to find time and energy to spend long hours in the Guyana National Archives and in the Caribbean Research Library at the University in Georgetown. In addition to a number of monographs, the ultimate fruit of that disciplined and sacrificial work will appear when the Johns Hopkins University Press publishes Walter's History of the Guyanese Working People, 1888-1905. He also published during this period of intensified struggle and important text, Guyanese Sugar Plantations in the late 19th century. Meanwhile, he continued to organize. Before 1974 was over, Walter had helped to centralize the Working People's Alliance. This became his political base in the relentless struggle to build a force that would bring about the revolutionary transformation of the Guyanese society. With the help of many persons in the United States and other parts of the world, Walter found opportunities to lecture and teach in an attempt to keep in touch with his comrades outside of Guyana and to earn the funds his family needed. Whenever Walter traveled abroad, especially as the government's repression increased, many friends urged him to leave Guyana and bring himself and his family to some place of relative safety. Walter's response to us generally had two parts. First was his sense of the responsibility he had to his comrades and the people of Guyana. He said that he was working among them to encourage them in a fearless struggle for the transformation of themselves and their society, and that he could not leave simply because he happened to have ready access to the means of escape. Second, Rodney said he felt he had been singularly privileged in the broad set of contacts he had been able to establish in the course of his work and travels throughout the Third World. For him, this privilege carried with it a responsibility to continue to share with his people the content and spirit of that international network of women and men involved in liberation struggles, thus without any trace of a desire for martyrdom, but with a clear recognition of the situation he faced. Walter's response was always the same. It is imperative that I stay here. Toward the end, all these dangers, hopes, and tensions were concentrated in the events of one last year-long outpouring of life and death. In June 1979, the WPA formally announced that it had transformed itself into a political party, one that would work untiringly for the overthrow of the stronghold that Burnham's People's National Congress had established in the country. In the following month, a government building in Georgetown was set afire, and Walter and four other WPA members were among the eight persons arrested and charged with arson. Because it was a government building, the charge was very serious, but it was also clear to many observers that the action was entirely set up as part of the measures for breaking the force of Rodney's small but influential organization. On the day of the arraignment, Father Bernard Donquet, a priest who was a reporter for the Catholic Standard, was fatally stabbed in the back as he stood observing a pro-WPA demonstration outside the court building. From that point on, a repressive situation deteriorated into what might be called a long night of official terrorism, including bombings, police beatings, and escalating threats of extermination by Burnham against Walter and other leaders of the opposition WPA. By the end of February 1980, two of Walter's close associates in the WPA, Ohene Kouama and Edward Dublin, had been killed by the police, others shot and beaten, still others jailed, their houses raided, ransacked, and bombed. By then, some of the leading members of the WPA were actually being held as political prisoners in Guyana, for their government refused them permission to leave the country. However, Rodney managed to get out in May 1980, accepting an invitation from the Patriotic Front to attend the independence ceremonies in Zimbabwe. Then Walter returned to Guyana, continuing to work in the archives, to organize among the people. He had ominously told some of us in this country that we might not see him again. On June 2nd, the trial for arson began, witnessed by concerned observers from the Caribbean, the United States, and England. Within a few days, it was clear that the government had no case and could not prosecute Rodney and his co-workers. As a result, on June 6th, at the request of the government, the trial was adjourned until August 20th. 1 week after the adjournment on Friday evening, June 13th, Walter was sitting in his brother's car waiting for Donald Rodney at the driver's seat. They had stopped at the house of a man who we now know had infiltrated the ranks of the WPA. Donald Rodney went in to pick up what the man said was a walkie-talkie that Walter wanted. As they stood in the infiltrator's yard around 7:30 p.m., he told Rodney to drive off and wait for a test signal at 8 o'clock. Donald returned to the car and drove away. When the signal came, it turned out to be the explosion that ended Walter Rodney's life. A few weeks before his death, Rodney had been persistently interviewed about the dangers that he faced and his plans for defending himself against them. He said, "As to my own safety, and the safety of a number of other persons within the WPA, we will try to guarantee our safety by the level of political mobilization and political action inside and outside of the country. Ultimately, it is this, rather than any kind of physical defense, which will guarantee our safety. None of us are unmindful of the threat that is constantly posed. We don't regard ourselves as adventurers, as martyrs, or potential martyrs, but we think there is a job which needs to be done, and at a certain point in time, we have to do what has to be done." Again, Walter's courageous sense of commitment and integrity evokes sharp memories of Fanon. He too sacrificed his life for the liberation of his people and died before he was 40. He too called the children of Africa and all those damned by Europe to seize the initiative and change our ways. He too asked us to resist all temptations to live out our lives as permanent victims, angry accusers, or fawning imitators of Europe. It was he who said, "Come then, comrades. The European game has finally ended. Look at them today swaying between atomic and spiritual disintegration. We must find something different. We today can do everything, so long as we do not imitate Europe. So long as we are not obsessed by the desire to catch up with Europe, we have taken the liberty at this point of changing Europe to Europe/America. We think Fanon would permit that. The Third World faces Europe/America like a colossal mass whose aim should be to try to resolve the problems to which Europe/America has not been able to find the answers. So, comrades, let us not pay tribute to Europe/America by creating states, institutions, and societies which draw their inspiration from her. If we want humanity to advance a step further, if we want to bring it up to a different level than that which Europe/America has shown it, then we must invent and we must make discoveries. If we wish to live up to our people's expectations, we must seek the response elsewhere than in Europe/America. For Europe/America, for ourselves, and for humanity, comrades. We must turn over a new leaf, we must work out new concepts, and we must try to set afoot a new man." From Walter's perspective, that was the job that needs to be done, the challenge that he and his comrades had determined to take on, experimenting, inventing, risking, trying to work out new forms of organization, new modus of struggle, new visions and concepts to guide and undergird them, starting on their own home ground. For Walter Rodney, the WPA was one element of the job, and his research and writing was another. He saw no contradiction between them. All elements of the task were held firmly together by the righteous integrity of his life, the disciplined power of his visions, and his undying love for the people and their possibilities. Thus he went about doing the job that needed to be done. But as it was said of Malcolm X, so it could be said of Walter. He became much more than there was time for him to be. Now we are starkly aware of the fact that the time he no longer has is really ours, that the job he took on is in our hands to continue, to redefine, wherever we are, whoever we are. The call that he tried to answer is here for us all if we want humanity to advance a step further. We must invent, and we must make discoveries. We must turn over a new leaf. We must work out our new concepts. We must try to set afoot a new humanity. Walter's legacy. It is in our courageous, creative attempts to respond to such a magnificent summons that we begin to break the chains of our underdevelopment and shake the foundations of all human exploitation. And is it not clear by now that the process of exploitation leads to an underdeveloped humanity both at the center and at the periphery? Do we not see that the underdevelopment of the center, in the homeland of the exploiters, is simply covered over with material possessions and deadly weaponry, but that the nakedness and human retardation are nevertheless there? So who among us does not need to break the coils of the past, to transcend and recreate our history? Perhaps it is only as we take up the challenge of Walter and Fanon that we will be prepared to give up all the deadly games of the last half millennia, seeking out new means of defense, new forms of struggle, new pathways toward revolution, new visions of what truly humane society demands of us. Only as we begin to entertain such thoughts, consider such inventions, will we be prepared to carefully examine again, and then move beyond the marvelous limits of how Europe underdeveloped Africa, pressing on, in the spirit of Rodney and Fanon, to ask a new question. How shall we redevelop the world? Beginning with ourselves, beginning where we are, what must we tear down? What must we build up? What foundations must we lay? Who shall we work with? What visions can we create? What hopes shall possess us? How shall we organize? How shall we be related to those who raise the same questions in South Africa, in El Salvador, in Guyana? How shall we communicate with others the urgency of our time? How shall we envision and work for the revolutionary transformation of our own country? What are the inventions, the discoveries, the new concepts that will help us move toward the revolution we need in this land? Neither rhetoric nor coercion will serve us now. We must decide whether we shall remain crippled and underdeveloped, or move to participate in our own healing by taking on the challenge to redevelop ourselves, our people, our endangered nation, and the earth. No one can force us toward this. By conventional measurements, there are no guarantees of success, as the blood of our martyrs and heroes known and less known, like Walter Rodney and Frantz Fanon, Ruby Doris and Fanny Lou, Malcolm and Martin fully testify. But there is a world waiting for us. Indeed, many worlds await us. One is the world of our children, not yet born, or just beginning, but wanting to live, to grow, to become their best possible selves. This will not happen unless, as Walter suggests, the center is transformed and fundamentally changed. That will not happen unless we are transformed, redeveloped, and renewed. The future of our children depends upon these rigorous transformations. The Afro-American Challenge. Then there is another, more difficult world that awaits us, the world of the sons and daughters of Europe/America who have begun to discover their own underdevelopment, who recognize the warping and desensitizing of their spirits. Without rehearsing all the old political arguments about coalitions and alliances, neither forgetting the past nor being bound by it, we must find some way to respond to them and to allow them to come in touch with us. This is no passing luxury in the old nice relations style. Rather, we now realize that the children of the oppressed and the children of the oppressors are involved in a dialectical relationship that is deeper than most of us choose to recognize, and that there is no fundamental redevelopment for one without the other. This is a heavy burden, but it represents a great possibility as well. In this country, with our peculiar history, it is also an undeniable reality. So it is by the way of these difficult issues that we return to Walter and his great work. Now what seems demanded of us as we revisit how Europe underdeveloped Africa is that we consider it this time in the light of Walter Rodney's life and death, this time in the consciousness of the dangerous, explosive American center, this time in the company of our children, this time in the presence of Fanon's insistent call to us all. Then we shall likely see more clearly than ever before that Europe's underdevelopment of Africa and other worlds required Europe's ravaging of itself and everyone and everything that came under its sway. So the wounded are all around us and within us, now opening ourselves to all those who recognize the brutal dialectics of underdevelopment, who acknowledge the cohesive powers of our common needs, our common dangers, and our common possibilities. We can begin to stand in a newly grounded solidarity and reach out toward each other, facing the harsh but beautiful fact that we must either redevelop ourselves and our world, or be pushed together into some terrible, explosive closing of the light. Of course, if we choose to go the way of our essential community, we cannot go far by responding primarily to the urgency of fear, for that would repeat history rather than transform it, and that would be unfaithful to a courageous brother like Walter. Instead, we must be drawn by the fact that there is much to attract us. For instance, one of the hopeful elements on the other side of the patterns of domination slash subordination of the past 500 years has been the drawing of humankind into networks of communication and interrelatedness that hold great possibilities for the establishment of new communities beyond the traditional national barriers. Reshaped and redirected, the mechanisms of exploitation may actually place some vital means of redevelopment within our grasp. Now it is in our hands to overcome our history, to break the shackles of the past, to redevelop ourselves, our people, our nation, and our world, to find humane, creative, and fearless ways of dealing with those who presently oppose such development. These are audacious visions and truly awesome responsibilities. But we must go forward. Indeed, it seems clear to us that even without any guarantees of success, we must move in the flow of humankind's best, most creative imagination in the direction of our most profoundly renewing dreams. Anything less is inadequate for the perilous times. Anything less would be unworthy of the memory of our brother, the needs of our children, or the magnificent untapped capacities of our own best selves. March, 1981. Vincent Harding, Robert Hill, William Strickland. Chapter 1. Some Questions on Development. In contrast with the surging growth of the countries in the socialist camp, and the development taking place, albeit much more slowly, in the majority of the capitalist countries, is the unquestionable fact that a large proportion of the so-called underdeveloped countries are in total stagnation, and that in some of them, the rate of economic growth is lower than that of population increase. These characteristics are not fortuitous. They correspond strictly to the nature of the capitalist system in full expansion, which transfers to the dependent countries the most abusive and barefaced forms of exploitation. It must be clearly understood that the only way to solve the questions now besetting mankind is to eliminate completely the exploitation of dependent countries by developed capitalist countries, with all the consequences that this implies. Che Guevara, 1964. What is development? Development in human society is a many-sided process. At the level of the individual, it implies increased skill and capacity, greater freedom, creativity, self-discipline, responsibility, and material well-being. Some of these are virtually moral categories and are difficult to evaluate, depending as they do on the age in which one lives, one's class origins, and one's personal code of what is wrong. However, what is indisputable is that the achievement of any of those aspects of personal development is very much tied in with the state of the society as a whole. From earliest times, man found it convenient and necessary to come together in groups to hunt, and for the sake of survival. The relations which develop within any given social group are crucial to an understanding of the society as a whole. Freedom, responsibility, skill have real meaning only in terms of the relations of men in society. Of course, each social group comes into contact with others. The relations between individuals in any two societies are regulated by the form of the two societies. Their respective political structures are important because the ruling elements within each group are the ones that begin to have dialogue, trade, or fight, as the case may be. At the level of social groups, therefore, development implies an increasing capacity to regulate both internal and external relationships. Much of human history has been a fight for survival against natural hazards and against real and imagined human enemies. Development in the past has always meant the increase in the ability to guard the independence of the social group and indeed to infringe upon the freedom of others, something that often came about irrespective of the will of the persons within the societies involved. Men are not the only beings that operate in groups, but the human species embarked upon a unique line of development because man had the capacity to make and use tools. The very act of making tools was a stimulus to increasing rationality rather than the consequence of a fully matured intellect. In historical terms, man, the worker, was every bit as important as man, the thinker, because the work with tools liberated men from sheer physical necessity so that he could impose himself upon other more powerful species and upon nature itself. The tools with which men work and the manner in which they organize their labor are both important indices of social development. More often than not, the term development is used in an exclusive economic sense, the justification being that the type of economy is itself an index of other social features. What then is economic development? A society develops economically as its members increase jointly their capacity for dealing with the environment. This capacity for dealing with the environment is dependent on the extent to which they understand the laws of nature, science, on the extent to which they put that understanding into practice by devising tools, technology, and on the manner in which work is organized. Taking a long-term view, it can be said that there has been constant economic development within human society since the origins of man, because man has multiplied enormously his capacity to win a living from nature. The magnitude of man's achievement is best understood by reflecting on the curly history of human society and noting the following. Firstly, the progress from crude stone tools to the use of metals. Secondly, the changeover from hunting and gathering wild fruit to the domestication of animals and the growing of food crops. And thirdly, the improvement in organization of work from being an individualistic activity towards being an activity which assumes a social character through the participation of many. Every people have shown a capacity for independently increasing their ability to live a more satisfactory life through exploiting the resources of nature. Every continent independently participated in the early epochs of the extension of man's control over his environment, which means, in effect, that every continent can point to a period of economic development. Africa, being the original home of man, was obviously a major participant in the processes in which human groups displayed an ever-increasing capacity to extract a living from the natural environment. Indeed, in the early period, Africa was the focus of the physical development of man as such, as distinct from other living beings. Development was universal because the conditions leading to economic expansion were universal. Everywhere, man was faced with the task of survival by meeting fundamental material needs, and better tools were a consequence of the interplay between human beings and nature as part of the struggle for survival. Of course, human history is not a record of advances and nothing else. There were periods in every part of the world when there were temporary setbacks and actual reduction of the capacity to produce basic necessities and other services for the population. But the overall tendency was towards increased production, and at given points of time, the increase in the quantity of goods was associated with a change in the quality or character of society. This will be shown later with reference to Africa, but to indicate the universal application of the principle of quantitative/qualitative change, an example will be drawn from China. Early man in China lived at the mercy of nature, and slowly discovered such basic things as the fact that fire can be man-made, and that seeds of some grasses could be planted in the soil to meet food requirements. Those discoveries helped inhabitants of China to have simple farming communities using stone tools and producing enough for bare subsistence. That was achieved several thousand years ago before the birth of Christ or the flight of the Prophet Muhammad. The goods produced at that stage were divided more or less equally among the members of society who lived and worked in families. By the time of the Tang Dynasty of the 7th century AD, China had expanded its economic capacity not only to grow more food, but also to manufacture a wide variety of items such as silks, porcelain, chips, and scientific devices. This, of course, represented a quantitative increase in the goods produced, and it was interrelated with qualitative changes in Chinese society. By the later date, there was a political state, where before there were only self-governing units. Instead of every family and every individual performing the tasks of agriculturalists, house builders, tailors, there had arisen specialization of function. Most of the population still tilled the land, but there were skilled artisans who made silk and porcelain, bureaucrats who administered the state, and Buddhist and Confucian religious philosophers who specialized in trying to explain those things that lay outside of immediate understanding. Specialization and division of labor led to more production, as well as inequality in distribution. A small section of Chinese society came to take a disproportionate share of the proceeds of human labor, and that was the section which did least to actually generate wealth by working in agriculture or industry. They could afford to do so because grave inequalities had emerged in the ownership of the basic means of production, which was the land. Family land became smaller as far as most peasants were concerned, and a minority took over the greater portion of the land. Those changes in land tenure were part and parcel of development in its broadest sense. That is why development cannot be seen purely as an economic affair, but rather as an overall social process which is dependent upon the outcome of man's efforts to deal with his natural environment. Through careful study, it is possible to comprehend some of the very complicated links between the changes in the economic base and changes in the rest of the superstructure of the society, including the sphere of ideology and social beliefs. The changeover from communalism in Asia and Europe led, for instance, to codes of behavior peculiar to feudalism. The conduct of the European knights in armor had much in common with that of the Japanese samurai, or warriors. They developed notions of so-called chivalry, conduct becoming a gentleman knight on horseback. While in contrast, the peasant had to learn extreme humility, deference, and obsequiousness, symbolized by doffing his cap and standing bareheaded before his superiors. In Africa, too, it was to be found that the rise of the state and superior classes led to the practice whereby common subjects prostrated themselves in the presence of the monarchs and aristocrats. When that point had been reached, it became clear that the rough equality of the family had given way to a new state of society. In the natural sciences, it is well known that in many instances, quantitative change becomes qualitative after a certain period. The common example is the way that water can absorb heat, a quantitative process, until at 100 degrees Celsius, it changes to steam, a qualitative change of form. Similarly, in human society, it has always been the case that the expansion of the economy leads eventually to a change in the form of social relations. Karl Marx, writing in the 19th century, was the first writer to appreciate this, and he distinguished within European history several stages of development. The first major stage, following after simple bands of hunters, was communalism, where property was collectively owned, work was done in common, and goods were shared equally. The second was slavery, caused by the extension of domineering elements within the family and by some groups being physically overwhelmed by others. Slaves did a variety of tasks, but their main job was to produce food. The next stage was feudalism, where agriculture remained the principal means of making a livelihood, but the land which was necessary for that purpose was in the hands of the few, and they took the lion's share of the wealth. The workers on the land, now called serfs, were no longer the personal property of the masters, but were tied to the land of a particular manor or estate. When the manor changed hands, the serfs had to remain there and provide goods for the landlord, just keeping enough to feed themselves. Just as the child of a slave was a slave, So the children of serfs were also serfs. Then came capitalism, under which the greatest wealth in the society was produced not in agriculture, but by machines, in factories, and in mines. Like the preceding phase of feudalism, capitalism was characterized by the concentration in a few hands of ownership of the means of producing wealth and by unequal distribution of the products of human labor. The few who dominated were the bourgeoisie, who had originated in the merchants and craftsmen of the feudal epoch, and who rose to be industrialists and financiers. Meanwhile, the serfs were declared legally free to leave the land and go in search of employment in capitalist enterprises. Their labor thereby became a commodity, something to be bought and sold. It was predicted that there would be a further stage, that of socialism, in which the principle of economic equality would be restored, as in communalism. In the present century, the phase of socialism has indeed emerged in some countries. Economically, each succeeding stage represented development in the strict sense that there was increased capacity to control the material environment and thereby to create more goods and services for the community. The greater quantity of goods and services were based on greater skills and human inventiveness. Man was liberated in the sense of having more opportunities to display and develop his talents. Whether man uplifted himself in a moral sense is open to dispute. The advance in production increased the range of powers which sections of society had over other sections, and it multiplied the violence which was part of the competition for survival and growth among social groups. It is not all clear that a soldier serving capitalism in the last World War was less primitive in the elemental sense of the word than a soldier serving in one of Japan's feudal armies in the 16th century, or for that matter, than a hunter living in the first phase of human organization in the forests of Brazil. Nevertheless, we do know that in those three respective epochs, hunting land, feudalism, capitalism, the quality of life improved. It became less hazardous and less uncertain, and members of society potentially had greater choice over their destinies. All of that is involved when the word development is used. In the history of those societies which have passed through several modes of production, the opportunity is presented of seeing how quantitative changes give rise ultimately to an entirely different society. The key feature is that, at given junctures, the social relations in the society were no longer effective in promoting advance. Indeed, they began to act as brakes on the productive forces and therefore had to be discarded. Take, for instance, the epoch of slavery in Europe. However morally indefensible slavery may have been, it did serve for a while to open up the mines and agricultural plantations in large parts of Europe, and notably within the Roman Empire. But then those peasants who remained free had their labor depressed and underutilized because of the presence of slaves. The slaves were not disposed to work at any tasks requiring skills, so the technological evolution of society threatened to come to a halt. Furthermore, the slaves were restless, and slave revolts were expensive to put down. The landowners, seeing their estates going to ruin, decided that it would be best to grant the legal freedom for which slaves were clamoring and to keep exploiting the labor of these free serfs by ensuring that they had no lands to plow other than those of the landlords. Thereby, a new set of social relations, that of landlord and serf, replaced the old relations of slave master and slave. In some instances, the changeover to a new mode was accompanied by violence at a critical point. This occurred when the ruling classes involved were being threatened with removal by the process of change. The feudal landlords remained in power for centuries, during which the merchant and manufacturing interests grew wealthy and sought to achieve political power and social preeminence. When classes are so well defined, their consciousness is at a high level. Both the landlord class and the capitalists recognized what was at stake. The former fought to hold on to the social relations which no longer correspond to the new technology of machine production and the organization of work by means of purchasing labor power. The capitalists flung themselves into revolutions in Europe in the 18th and 19th centuries to break the old relations of production. The notions of revolution and class consciousness must be borne in mind when it comes to examining the situation of the modern worker and peasant classes in Africa. However, for the greater part of Africa's history, the existing classes have been incompletely crystallized, and the changes have been gradual rather than revolutionary. What is probably of more relevance for early African development is the principle that development over the world's territories has always been uneven. While all societies have experienced development, it is equally true that the rate of development differed from continent to continent, and within each continent, different parts increased their command over nature at different rates. Inside Africa, Egyptians were capable of producing wealth in abundance 25 centuries ago because of mastery of many scientific natural laws and their invention or technology to irrigate, grow food, and extract minerals from the subsoil. At that time, hunting with bows and even wooden clubs was what people depended on for survival in most parts of the African continent and in various other places, such as the British Isles. One of the most difficult questions to answer is exactly why different peoples developed at different rates when left on their own. Part of the answer lies in the environment in which human groups evolved, and part of it lies in the superstructure of human society. That is to say, as human beings battled with the material environment, they created forms of social relations, forms of government, patterns of behavior, and systems of belief which together constituted the superstructure, which was never the same in any two societies. Each element in the superstructure interacted with other elements in the superstructure, as well as with the material base. For instance, the political and religious patterns affected each other and were often intertwined. The religious belief that a certain forest was sacred was the kind of element in the superstructure that affected economic activity, since that forest would not be cleared for cultivation. While in the final analysis, the breakthrough to a new stage of human development is dependent upon man's technical capacity to deal with the environment, it is also to be borne in mind that peculiarities in the superstructure of any given society have a marked impact on the rate of development. Many observers have been puzzled by the fact that China never became capitalist. It entered the feudal phase of development virtually 1,000 years before the birth of Christ. It had developed many aspects of technology, and it had many craftsmen and artisans. Yet the mode of production was never transformed to one where machines were the main means of producing wealth, and where the owners of capital would be the dominant class. The explanation is very complex, but in general terms, the main differences between feudal Europe and feudal China lay in the superstructure, that is, in the body of beliefs, motivations, and socio-political institutions which derived from the material base, but in turn affected it. In China, religious, educational, and bureaucratic qualifications were of utmost importance, and government was in the hands of state officials rather than being run by the landlords on their own feudal estates. Besides, there were greater egalitarian tendencies in Chinese land distribution than in European land distribution, and the Chinese state owned a great deal of land. The consequence was that the landowners had greater powers as bureaucrats than as men of property, and they used that to keep social relations in the same mold. It would have been impossible for them to have done that indefinitely, but they slowed down the movement of history. In Europe, the elements of change were not stifled by the weight of a state bureaucracy. As soon as the first capitalist appeared in European society, an incentive was created for further development through the attitude of this class. Never before in any human society had a group of people seen themselves consciously functioning in order to make the maximum profit out of production. To fulfill their objective of acquiring more and more capital, capitalists took a greater interest in the laws of science, which could be harnessed in the form of machinery to work and make profit on their behalf. At the political level, capitalism was also responsible for most of the features which today are referred to as Western democracy. In abolishing feudalism, the capitalists insisted on parliaments, constitutions, freedom of the press. These too can be considered as development. However, the peasants and workers of Europe, and eventually the inhabitants of the whole world, paid a huge price so that the capitalists could make their profits from the human labor that always lies behind the machines. That contradicts other facets of development, especially viewed from the standpoint of those who suffered and still suffered to make capitalist achievements possible. This latter group are the majority of mankind. To advance, they must overthrow capitalism, and that is why at the moment capitalism stands in the path of further human social development. To put it another way, the social class relations of capitalism are now outmoded, just as slave and feudal relations became outmoded in their time. There was a period when the capitalist system increased the well-being of significant numbers of people as a byproduct of seeking out profits for a few. But today, the quest for profits comes into sharp conflict with people's demands that their material and social needs should be fulfilled. The capitalist or bourgeois class is no longer capable of guiding the uninhibited development of science and technology, again, because these objectives now clash with the profit motive. Capitalism has proved incapable of transcending fundamental weaknesses such as underutilization of productive capacity, the persistence of a permanent sector of unemployed, and periodic economic crises related to the concept of market, which is concerned with people's ability to pay rather than their need for commodities. Capitalism has created its own irrationalities, such as a vicious white racism, the tremendous waste associated with advertising, and the irrationality of incredible poverty in the midst of wealth, and wastage even inside the biggest capitalist economies, such as that of the United States of America. Above all, capitalism has intensified its own political contradictions in trying to subjugate nations and continents outside of Europe, so that workers and peasants in every part of the globe have become self-conscious and are determined to take their destiny into their own hands. Such a determination is also an integral part of the process of development. It can be offered as a generalization that all phases of development are temporary or transient and are destined sooner or later to give way to something else. It is particularly important to stress this with reference to capitalism, because the capitalist epoch is not quite over, and those who live at a particular point in time often fail to see that their way of life is in the process of transformation and elimination. Indeed, it is one of the functions of those bourgeois writers who justify capitalism to try and pretend that capitalism is here to stay. A glance at the remarkable advance of socialism over the last 50-odd years will show that the apologists for capitalism are spokesmen of a social system that is rapidly expiring. The fact that capitalism today is still around alongside socialism should warn us that the modes of production cannot simply be viewed as a question of successive stages. Uneven development has always ensured that societies have come into contact when they were at different levels. For example, one that was communal and one that was capitalist. When two societies of different sorts come into prolonged and effective contact, the rate and character of change taking place in both is seriously affected to the extent that entirely new patterns are created. Two general rules can be observed to apply in such cases. First, the weaker of the two societies, that is, the one with less economic capacity, is bound to be adversely affected, and the bigger the gap between the two societies concerned, the more detrimental are the consequences. For example, when European capitalism came into contact with the indigenous hunting societies of America and the Caribbean, the latter were virtually exterminated. Second, assuming that the weaker society does survive, then ultimately it can resume its own independent development only if it proceeds to a level higher than that of the economy which had previously dominated it. The concrete instances of the operation of this second rule are found in the experience of the Soviet Union, China, and Korea. China and Korea were both at a stage approximating feudalism when they were colonized by the capitalist powers of Europe and Japan. Russia was never legally colonized, but while in the feudal stage and before its own indigenous capitalism could get very far, the Russian economy was subjugated by the more mature capitalism of Western Europe. In all three cases, it took a socialist revolution to break the domination of capitalism, and only the rapid tempo of socialist development could make amends for the period of subjugation when growth was misdirected and retarded. Indeed, as far as the two biggest socialist states are concerned, the Soviet Union and China, socialist development has already catapulted them beyond states such as Britain and France, which have been following the capitalist path for centuries. Up to the end of the 1950s, the point at which this study terminates, Russia, China, Korea, and certain nations in Eastern Europe were the only countries which had decisively broken with capitalism and imperialism. Imperialism is itself a phase of capitalist development in which Western European capitalist countries, the USA, and Japan established political, economic, military, and cultural hegemony over other parts of the world which were initially at a lower level and therefore could not resist domination. Imperialism was, in effect, the extended capitalist system, which for many years embraced the whole world, one part being the exploiters and the other the exploited, one part being dominated and the other acting as overlords, one part making policy and the other being dependent. Socialism has advanced on imperialism's weakest flanks, in the sector that is exploited, oppressed, and reduced to dependency. In Asia and Eastern Europe, socialism released the nationalist energies of colonized peoples. It turned the goal of production away from the money market and towards the satisfaction of human needs. It has eradicated bottlenecks such as permanent unemployment and periodic crises. And it has realized some of the promise implicit in Western or bourgeois democracy by providing the equality of economic condition which is necessary before one can make use of political equality and equality before the law. Socialism has reinstated the economic equality of communalism, but communalism fell apart because of low economic productivity and scarcity. Socialism aims at and has significantly achieved the creation of plenty, so that the principle of egalitarian distribution becomes consistent with the satisfaction of the wants of all members of society. One of the most crucial factors leading to more rapid and consistent expansion of economic capacity under socialism has been the implementation of planned development. Most of the historical processes so far described relate to involuntary and unplanned development. No one planned that at a given stage human beings should cease using stone axes and use iron implements instead. And, to come to more recent times, while individual capitalist firms plan their own expansion, their system is not geared to overall planning of the economy and the society. The capitalist state intervened only fitfully and partially to supervise capitalist development. The socialist state has as its prime function the control of the economy on behalf of the working classes. The latter, that is, workers and peasants, have now become the most dynamic force in world history and human development. To conclude this brief introduction to the extremely complex problem of social development, it is useful to recognize how inadequate are the explanations of that phenomenon which are provided by bourgeois scholars. They very seldom try to grapple with the issue in its totality, but rather concentrate attention narrowly on economic development. As defined by the average bourgeois economist, development becomes simply a matter of the combination of given factors of production, namely land, population, capital, technology, specialization, and large-scale production. Those factors are indeed relevant, as is implied in the analysis so far, but omissions from the list of what bourgeois scholars think relevant are really overwhelming. No mention is made of the exploitation of the majority, which underlay all development prior to socialism. No mention is made of the social relations of production or of classes. No mention is made of the way that the factors and relations of production combine to form a distinctive system or mode of production, varying from one historical epoch to another. No mention is made of the imperialism as a logical phase of capitalism. In contrast, any approach which tries to base itself on socialist and revolutionary principles must certainly introduce into the discussion at the earliest possible point the concepts of class, imperialism, and socialism, as well as the role of the workers and oppressed peoples. Each new concept bristles with its own complications, and it is not to be imagined that the mere resort to certain terminology is the answer to anything. However, one has at least to recognize the full human, historical, and social dimensions of development before it is feasible to consider underdevelopment or the strategies for escaping from underdevelopment. What is underdevelopment? Having discussed development, it is easier to comprehend the concept of underdevelopment. Obviously, underdevelopment is not absence of development because every people have developed in one way or another and to a greater or lesser extent. Underdevelopment makes sense only as a means of comparing levels of development. It is very much tied to the fact that human social development has been uneven, and from a strictly economic viewpoint, some human groups have advanced further by producing more and becoming more wealthy. The moment that one group appears to be wealthier than others, some inquiry is bound to take place as to the reason for the difference. After Britain had begun to move ahead of the rest of Europe in the 18th century, the famous British economist Adam Smith felt it necessary to look into the causes behind the wealth of nations. At the same time, many Russians were very concerned about the fact that their country was backward in comparison with England, France, and Germany in the 18th century, and subsequently in the 19th century. Today, our main preoccupation is with the differences in wealth between, on the one hand, Europe and North America, and on the other hand, Africa, Asia, and Latin America. In comparison with the first, the second group can be said to be backward or underdeveloped. At all times, therefore, one of the ideas behind underdevelopment is a comparative one. It is possible to compare the economic conditions at two different periods for the same country and determine whether or not it had developed. And more importantly, it is possible to compare the economics of any two countries at any given period of time. A second and even more indispensable component of modern underdevelopment is that it expresses a particular relationship of exploitation, namely the exploitation of one country by another. All of the countries named as underdeveloped in the world are exploited by others, and the underdevelopment with which the world is now preoccupied is a product of capitalist, imperialist, and colonialist exploitation. African and Asian societies were developing independently until they were taken over directly or indirectly by the capitalist powers. When that happened, exploitation increased, and the export of surplus ensued, depriving the societies of the benefit of their natural resources and labor. This is an integral part of underdevelopment in the contemporary sense. In some quarters, it has often been thought wise to substitute the term developing for underdeveloped. One of the reasons for so doing is to avoid any unpleasantness which may be attached to the second term, which might be interpreted as meaning underdeveloped mentally, physically, morally, or in any other respect. Actually, if underdevelopment were related to anything other than comparing economies, then the most underdeveloped country in the world would be the United States, which practices external oppression on a massive scale, while internally there is a blend of exploitation, brutality, and psychiatric disorder. However, on the economic level, it is best to remain with the word underdeveloped rather than developing, because the latter creates the impression that all the countries of Africa, Asia, and Latin America are escaping from a state of economic backwardness relative to the industrial nations of the world, and that they are emancipating themselves from the relationship of exploitation. That is certainly not true, and many underdeveloped countries in Africa and elsewhere are becoming more underdeveloped in comparison with the world's great powers because their exploitation by the metropoles is being intensified in new ways. Economic comparisons can be made by looking at statistical tables or indices of what goods and services are produced and used in the societies under discussion. Professional economists speak of the national income of countries and the national income per capita. These phrases have already become a part of the layman's language by way of the newspapers, and no detailed explanation will be offered here. It is enough to note that the national income is a measurement of the total wealth of the country, while the per capita income is a figure obtained by dividing the national income by the number of inhabitants in order to get an idea of the average wealth of each inhabitant. This average can be misleading where there are great extremes of wealth. A young Ugandan put it in a very personal form when he said that the per capita income of his country camouflaged the fantastic difference between what was earned by his poor peasant father and what was earned by the biggest local capitalist, Madvani. In considering the question of development away from the state of underdevelopment, it is of supreme importance to realize that such a process demands the removal of the gross inequalities of land distribution, property holding, and income, which are camouflaged behind national income figures. At one stage in history, advance was made at the cost of entrenching privileged groups. In our times, development has to mean advance which liquidates present privileged groups with their corresponding unprivileged groups. Nevertheless, the per capita income is a useful statistic for comparing one country with another, and the developed countries all have per capita incomes several times higher than any one of the recently independent African nations. The gap is not only great, but it is also increasing. Many people have come to realize that the developed countries are growing richer quite rapidly, while underdeveloped countries, for the most part, show stagnancy or slow rates of growth. In each country, a figure can be calculated to represent the rate at which the economy grows. The growth rate is highest in socialist countries, followed by the big capitalist countries, and with the colonies and ex-colonies trailing far behind. The proportion of international trade which is in the hands of the underdeveloped countries is declining. That proportion was roughly 30% in 1938 and went down to less than 20% in the 1960s. This is an important indicator because trade is both a reflection of the quantity of goods produced and a way of obtaining goods not locally produced. Developed economies have certain characteristics which contrast with underdeveloped ones. The developed countries are all industrialized. That is to say, the greater part of their working population is engaged in industry rather than agriculture, and most of their wealth comes out of mines, factories, and other industries. They have a high.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.